JDK 25 is driving me mad. Another release with so many additions. I'll have to think about how, now that the feature set is frozen, I can stuff all of that into one episode. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to go over everything that JDK 25 brings to Java, and it's a lot. Here's how we're going to fit all that into the time we have. A bunch of the features come after a series of previews that I've covered extensively in the past, and I will keep coverage of them short, very short. In fact, this short. JDK 25 finalizes the addition of a so-called prologue to constructor bodies before an explicit call to another constructor with this or super. The code it contains can do whatever it wants except reference the instance under construction for anything but field assignments. The prologue is great for easier validation, preparation, and sharing of arguments before passing them on to another constructor, which comes in particularly handy when writing records as they require constructor chaining. Yeah, that was quick, but I linked JDK enhanced proposals and deeper dive videos in the description that you can check out. Or if you don't want to troll all the videos, wait for the summer when we cover every final feature between Java 21 and 25 in a dedicated video series. But for today, it's just JDK 25 final and preview. First language, then APIs, then runtime, which has seen a surprising number of pretty cool last minute additions. Ready? Then let's dive right in. With a simple import module module name, you get to import the full public API of the named module, which is superior to star imports because it fully imports a coherent API instead of just a random slice of it. Whether they're preferable over the precision and clarity of single type imports remains a matter of taste, but there are situations where that hardly matters. Experiments, demos, scripts, early learning are some of them, and here you should probably default to module imports. This feature is final in JDK 25 without change. This one's a bit of a mouthful. Compact source files and instance main methods. Instance main methods allow the entry point to a program to be just void main, meaning neither public nor static nor needing arguments. And compact source files contain a main method but no class declaration, and they auto-import Java base. So collections, date and times, file IO, system interactions, etc. are already available. And then there's the new class IO, which makes it simpler to write to and read from the terminal. And it is now backed by system out and system in, by the way. All this is finally in JDK 25, and that's great for beginners, but also for the growing crowd of Java ponies like me who use it to write scripts. In Java. JavaScript, so to speak. This last language feature is still in preview in JDK 25 and unchanged over 24, still looking for more feedback. It's about adding primitive types to patterns, instance of and switch, which primarily files off a few weird edge cases the language would otherwise have, but is also handy when doing primitive conversion or pattern matching over types that contain primitives or their wrappers. For example, with a switch bool, case true, case false, case null, you can now kick that non-binary boolean's butt. With language features covered, let's turn towards APIs. Key derivation functions, KDFs, make use of cryptographic inputs, such as initial key material, a salt value, and a pseudorandom function, to create new, cryptographically strong key material. A KDF is often used to create cryptographic data from which multiple keys can be obtained. A KDF allows keys to be created in a manner that is both secure and reproducible by two parties sharing knowledge of the inputs. After the key encapsulation mechanism JDK 21, the KDF API, which is finally in JDK 25, is the second in a series of steps Java takes towards supporting hybrid public key encryption, which enables a smooth transition to quantum-safe encryption algorithms. This is of critical importance for the platform already now, so that data intercepted and stored today cannot be readily decrypted in a world with quantum computing. Scope values have been in preview for four releases now and are finally final in JDK 25. This API is about sharing immutable references to data with colleagues within a thread and within child threads in a way that is easier to use, more comprehensible, robust, and performant than thread locals. This comes at the expense of only passing data one way and within a predetermined scope, which is by far the most common use case. If you stumbled over the term child threads, let's talk about structure concurrency next. The structure concurrency API rethinks how to organize concurrency. It hinges on the idea that if a task splits into concurrent subtasks, the task should await their completion and process their errors or results in the same scope. This structure comes with a number of benefits. First, clarity of code that always follows the same procedure, set up the subtasks, wait for them to either complete or be cancelled, and decide whether to succeed or fail. Second is error handling with short circuiting, where a failing subtask can cancel other ongoing subtasks. There's cancellation propagation, where if a task gets cancelled, so do all of its subtasks, potentially down a large tree of tasks. Parent-child relationships between the thread running the task and those running the subtasks. And finally, observability, where thread dump clearly displays this thread slash task hierarchy. The API is in its fifth preview in JDK 25 and has seen a noticeable revamp over its earlier previews. If you have the chance, give it a try and report your experience to the Loom Dev mailing list. The Stable Values API offers lazy, exactly once initialization that at the same time enables aggressive just-in-time performance optimizations. This comes from close cooperation with the runtime, where the reference to the instance, once it gets created, is truly final and can't even be changed through reflection, something that is also true for record fields, but not for final fields in regular classes. The API follows a functional approach, where invocations of, for example, stable value supplier returns the supplier of the desired instance. Similar methods exist that return lazily populated collections. Stable values are new in JDK 25 and in their first preview. I'm sure you've seen these textual representations of cryptographic keys that start with five dashes, then in all caps, begin public key, for example, followed by another five dashes. Then comes a Base64 encoded representation of the key before the whole thing ends similar to how it started. The most likely place where you handled them is when you uploaded SSH or PGP keys to GitHub or to artifact repositories. Those text blocks were originally standardized to exchange cryptographic objects via email, and so the standard is called Privacy Enhanced Mail, or PEM for short. Starting as a preview in JDK 25, Java gets an API that can convert between PEMs and cryptographic objects that have standard representations in the binary formats PK, CS8, 1.2 and 2.0, as well as X5 or 9. This includes private and public keys, certificates and certificate revocation lists. Okay, let's talk about runtime improvements, and we'll start with garbage collection. Shenandoah gained an experimental generational mode in JDK 24, and after many stability and performance improvements, it's no longer experimental in 25, but considered production ready. It is not the default mode of Shenandoah though, and still needs to be enabled with --xx:\shenandoah_gc_mode=generational. This is in addition to --xx:\use_shenandoah_gc, of course. What you don't need anymore is --xx: plus unlock experimental VM options. Project Leiden pushes out its second launch time improvement, this one focused on warm-up time, the time between the first useful unit of work and peak performance. One thing the JVM does during that time is profiling methods to find out which are worth optimizing and how. If that happens during the training run and the profiles are stored in the AOT cache, they can be loaded from there instead of being collected in production, and the JIT compiler can generate native code immediately upon application startup. In JDK 25, this happens automatically during the AOT workflow, doesn't add any new constraints nor require code changes, and just like class loading and linking, will also be overruled at runtime if it turns out that the cached information doesn't line up with reality. So that new AOT optimization doesn't change the workflow, but this feature does. The AOT command triad is, first, observe a training run to create a cache configuration, then second, create a cache from it, and third, run the application with the cache. Starting in JDK 25, this workflow can be optionally shortened by combining the first two steps into one. So the result of the training run isn't the configuration, but the actual cache ready to be used in production. This will cover all simple and many advanced cases, but more complex configurations may still need to manually invoke all three steps. Every object on the heap has a so-called header that the JVM uses to track certain information, for example, for typing, locking, and garbage collection. From the point of view of the application, the additional memory consumption is overhead, and ideally it would be zero, but that's not going to happen. But compact object headers, which were introduced as an experimental feature in JDK 24, provides an alternative object header layout that reduces the overhead by a third to a half, which reduces overall memory consumption by 10 to 20% in typical cases. After thorough validation through extensive testing and production runs, this feature is now considered production ready. On JDK 25, you can enable it with the flag --xx:\plus use compact object headers. While this has a really good chance to reduce memory consumption and even CPU times through denser memory layout and reduced pressure on garbage collection, this is not guaranteed to be the case. So observe your application carefully and verify that it actually helps. To make it easier to time and trace invocations, be it to identify performance bottlenecks in production, to optimize code or to debug production issues, two new JDK flight recorder events are introduced: JDK method timing and JDK method trace. They allow execution times and stack traces to be recorded for specific methods, which are selected on the command line in configuration files with J command or JMX, And unlike sample-based profilers, they record complete and exact statistics. But this can impose a larger CPU overhead than the 1% JFR generally aims for and should be used for a few methods at a time. For larger numbers, sampling-based approaches remain recommended, which brings us to our second JFR improvement. When sampling data, it's essential to prevent selection biases. If, for example, I'd ask all of you to post your favorite programming mascot's name in the comments, I couldn't really expect a representative outcome, now could I? So when JFR samples stack traces to create execution time profiles, it's important to do that in regular intervals. But the issue is that the stack can only be reliably parsed at what's called a save point. This essentially jiggles the sample points into these save points, which results in what's called save point bias, where frequently executed span of code might not even show up in the profile because it doesn't contain a save point. JFR currently works around this by parsing the stack in fixed intervals with an unreliable heuristic and hoping that this works out often enough to lead to good results. Starting in JDK 25, JFR combines the best of both worlds by emitting sample requests in regular intervals that are then reliably reconstructed to full stack traces at the next save point. Editing Nikolai here, bringing you a feature that was targeted to JDK 25 just an hour ago at time of recording this, JFR CPU time profiling. Based on a kernel signal that is emitted at fixed intervals of CPU time, JFR can now create CPU time profiles for Java programs. They differ from the more common real-time profiles in that they do not include the time spent waiting for memory, the file system, network I/O, etc. Neither of these profiles is strictly better than the other. Real-time profiles are most helpful to reduce latency, whereas CPU time profiles are crucial to identifying CPU-intense methods which can limit throughput. For now, this feature only works on the best of operating systems, and it is experimental. Check JEP 509 for details, give it a try, and let the folks on the Hotspot JFR dev mailing list know about your experience. And finally, bad news for everyone who's using 32-bit x86 hardware, although that's not going to be a lot of you, if any. The port of the JDK was removed entirely in JDK 25, which means that new features like virtual threads, FFM or the vector API no longer need to implement 32-bit fallbacks, which was a major opportunity cost. And it also simplifies the JDK's build and test infrastructure. For more details, check the JEP that I linked in the description, which I did for all of these features, by the way. Or wait for an upcoming episode of the Inside Java podcast, where I discuss this and other deprecations and removals with the one and only Dr. Deprecator. Until then, be sure to check out the JDK 25 EA builds, and I'll see you again in 2 weeks. So long!